Hey everybody, what's going on? I am Gregg Sussman, joined today by Gabe Morency, who's here to break down the UFC Fight Night for this Wednesday night. What's happening, Gabe?
Ready to step back into the octagon. It was great to have the UFC back on Saturday night. It's going to be great to have it back two times this week again.
So let's get right into it. Our main events, Anthony Smith taking on Glover Teixeira. I know you like someone in this light heavyweight fight. Which fight are you going with?
Well, this is a fun fight, actually, between two very well-respected fighters for different reasons, actually. Glover Teixeira kind of arrived in the UFC a little bit later on in his career. Used to be known along with Fedor as sort of the best fighter not in the UFC. And he's had a hell of a run in the UFC. He's come close to winning a championship before, but he fell short. He's the type of guy that could beat pretty much anybody except the champion. You know, he couldn't beat John Jones, and we can say the same thing about Anthony Lionheart Smith. Anthony Smith is a complete journeyman, Greg. A guy that came out of nowhere. He's got like 14 losses on his resume, which is quite a lot. He's got 33 wins, too. But it seemed as he got, you know, into his late 20s, into his early 30s, and he's 31 right now. He sort of found himself. An interesting backstory about him leading into this fight. His home was invaded. He was sleeping with his family, and he heard like noise in his living room. He went downstairs. He lives in Nebraska. He went downstairs and there was an intruder. And he went toe to toe with the guy. And he said, I gave him elbows. I kicked him in the head. I went full UFC MMA on him. He took everything I had and kept coming back at me. And everybody sort of joked, well, I'm betting against this guy then in his next fight in a return to the octagon. But Glover Teixeira is not going to be hopped up on like Walter White Breaking Bad type drugs like the home invader was, or at least we hope. It's going to be a fun fight, but ultimately, I'm not getting in front of Anthony Smith right now. The line is a little higher than I would like it to be, but I don't set the numbers, right? It is what it is. It's the main event. I'm going to give you guys a pick for it. Smith is 4-1 in his last five fights. That one loss was to John Jones. Went 25 minutes with John Bones Jones. You know, beat Alexander Gustafsson in four rounds, man. An all-out war with the Swede as well. 7-2 in his last nine fights. Texas on a little bit of a run right now. He's won three fights in a row. We'll give him credit for that. But the fighters that he fought weren't as good as Anthony Smith. I think the age difference is going to be the difference in this fight. I think Smith is just going to be, you know, too young, too athletic to fall into Glover's trap. Glover likes to sort of use his stand-up and body shots to, you know, wear you out and set up a submission. I don't think it's going to happen against Anthony here. Give me Anthony Smith to win this fight, Greg. Should be a fun one.
Yeah, it's the main event. And those anecdotes were awesome, Gabe, hearing about Glover Teixeira. And, of course, Anthony Smith, the home invader. It's going to be a fun fight. This light heavyweight battle. We'll see if Smith can get the job done. As you said, the odds at minus 184 right now over on FanDuel, it's kind of high. We'll see what happens, obviously, on Fight Night on Wednesday. Let's move on to a heavyweight battle. And last week, you and I talked about the heavyweight fight and hoping it would go past 1.5 rounds. This week, you are going in an even further direction, right? You think this heavyweight battle between Ben Rothwell and OSP, it's not just going past the second round, it's going the distance.
Yeah, well, please, Greg, if we're doing a video in like 6 months or something like that, please like stop me from ever betting an under Francis Ngannou fight ever again. It's like, that's four fights in a row. That was violent. I thought Jairzinho was dead. I was like, oh my God, forget about coronavirus. I think someone just got murdered in the octagon. Like, the dude was not moving. He's a scary, scary dude. The other heavyweight fight, though, Verdum and Olnik, that went the distance, right? So, you know, you roll the dice with this stuff. But you're right, Greg. Listen, we're going to lay a little bit of juice sometimes, and we're going to get some take back as well. We mix it up with my picks. I'm not betting the numbers, guys. I'm going to stay away from something that's minus 330 or minus 400 or so. But, I'm picking a winner, not according to the number. And if it's an underdog pick, fine. If it's the favorite, fine. You can mix it up and mix and match with parlays too, guys, right? I'm just giving my suggestions for who I think are going to win the fights. So let's get into Ben Rothwell and OSP, not GSP, but Auvin St. Preux, OSP. Backstory here, Greg, he used to be a football player, Tennessee Volunteers. He was a pretty good college football player. Not good enough for the NFL good, though. And he got into fighting. He's okay. He's never been great, but he's lasted. He's had, you know, he's had quite a run as a mixed martial artist. He has gotten better. He's moving up right now to fight in a heavyweight division. He doesn't really have a ton of power to begin with. And Rothwell is a big dude, all right? Rothwell is a big dude with a lot of punching power. But he's kind of got the speed of Roy Nelson. Roy might be faster than him, actually. Ben's not the fastest guy. OSP is very prodding as well. Don't expect this to be the fight of the night, all right? This isn't going to be, at least in my opinion, I don't think this is going to be fireworks. I think it's going to be a slower prodding type of fight. And at plus 156, I'll take my shot that this fight goes the distance. I think the odds are high enough for me, Gregg, to be willing to roll the dice here that this can go 15 minutes. Not a championship fight. It's 15 minutes. OSP is a really tough dude. He's a smart athlete. I think he can avoid getting tagged. And I don't think he can drop Ben Rothwell. I've been wrong before. Let's hope I'm not wrong about this. But at plus 156, I'll take my chances.
Smart fighter is OSP. He's just got to survive for those three rounds. Go the distance. Go those 15 minutes. And you get that at plus 156 over at the FanDuel Sportsbook. And a slow-prodding fight. That's good news for this bet. Let's hope it goes the distance on Wednesday. Up next, a lightweight battle. Alexander Hernandez taking on Drew Dober here. Gabe, which way are you leaning?
You know, this is the fight that could be the fight of the night. On Saturday night, people were talking about the Luque and the Price fight, and it turned into like the fight of the year type of deal. There was once Price got hit in the face, and with no fans, I swear, Gregg, it was like a baseball bat to a ball. Like, you know, like when Mike Trout really gets one, and you just hear that, tuck, and you're like, oh, that ball's gone. Like, right away. I don't know how the hell Price got up after the fact. His face didn't get up. He did. But this is the fight that there's going to be blood. This is the one that both kids could really get after it. Younger guys in their fight prime. And there's a common theme here, guys, about guys that are fighting on this card. Most of them seem to think the virus is a hoax. Remember, Gregg, I told you about Bryce Mitchell? I said, this kid, man, he doesn't care. This kid's living in the woods in Arkansas. All right. Yeah. He thinks this virus is a political ploy to take his gun away. Right. I knew like the whole, you have to think about that. You notice, Gregg, a lot of the champions, some of them didn't want to fight right around now. They're like, there's too much going on. Other guys are bringing on. So now we get to Alexander Hernandez, Alexander the Great. I don't want to call him the Great. He hasn't done that much yet, but he is a good fighter. He thinks he already had the virus. In a typical fashion, he said he kicked its ass. Coronavirus is scared of him, and it won't come around him anymore. But what I like about this is he was talking about his training camp, and he said, my camp was the same. He goes, I trained with a bunch of crazy Brazilians that don't believe the virus is real anyways. He said, I already had it, and even if I had it, who cares? And even if I had it now, it doesn't matter. You can't stop me. So this kid, I like his mentality coming in here. Listen, Drew Dober's a tough kid as well, man. Nice run, 5-1 his last six in the cage. Hernandez is a heavily hyped fighter who's actually favored against Cowboy Cerrone. That was his loss at the UFC. But he's 9-1 in his last 10 fights. He's 3-1 in his four fights, Gregg. 27-year-old Hernandez is in the UFC. But we always talk about fighters needing to lose to learn how to win. And in the UFC, it's very, very critical. Like, losing in the UFC doesn't ruin your career. It makes you a stronger and smarter fighter moving forward. You're not going to learn anything if you're winning all the time, right? Like, so he sort of went back to the drawing board. He's ready for this fight. I was surprised by the number here. Like I said, Hernandez is always favored. He gets a lot of respect from the odds makers. He gets a lot of respect from the so-called sharps on the street all the time. So I was surprised to see him at plus 100. I'll roll the dice and take a shot with the underdog here, Gregg.
Plus 100, the number here for Alex Hernandez in what Gabe expects could be the fight of the night. Dober and Hernandez, two good fighters, two young fighters. It should be a fun one here in the cage. It's one I'm looking forward to on Wednesday. Let's move on to a Ricky Simon's battle here. As you expect, Gabe, this also to be a good fight between Ricky Simon and Ray Borg, this bantamweight battle. And not only do you think Ricky Simon's going to win, but you think Ray Borg's going to put up a hell of a fight here.
Yeah, this is going to be another fun fight, actually. Two warriors, two really tough guys. And I'd like to give a little backstory as well. Ray Borg's been through a lot. Remember when Conor McGregor went loco in Brooklyn and started throwing dollies through windows and stuff like that? Ray Borg actually got glass in his face, all right? He got glass. He was on that bus that Conor threw the dolly through. He got glass in his face. He couldn't fight. He had physical problems after the fact due to that the injury. It's hard to be a fighter and have glass in your eye after the fact and then be able to fight again. He had issues being compensated for it. And then the poor guy, him and his wife, had a child that was born with some brain issues and complications. And fortunately, the child made it, but he's been through a lot. He's a really, really likable guy. I wanted to take him here. I was like, it was my boy Ray Borg, man. Tough guy. He's been through a lot. But you know what? Betting on feelings doesn't pay the bills, Sussman. And we got to go with a fighter here in Ricky Simon. He's just a bigger guy. He's going to be 2 inches taller. He's got a 6-inch reach advantage as well. I think that's going to be a difference here. It's going to be an uphill climb for Borg. He's going to need everything to go his way to be able to win this fight. So I like Ricky Simon to win this fight. He's minus 164. I'd prefer it was like minus 140 or 50, but hey, it is what it is. We got to deal with the numbers that they give us. So we think Ricky Simon wins the fight. Now, here's a good angle for you guys here, guys. I don't like laying minus 240 ever on anything, really. But this is nice parlay material for you. This fight will go the distance, all right? It's minus 240. Will the fight go the distance? Ray Borg's last 9 fights, Greg, have gone the distance. 9 straight fights. Oh, yeah, Simon, 8 of his last 9 fights have gone the distance. So it's a 15-minute fight, smaller dudes. For my money, I don't have a problem with this. I'm going to mix it. I'm going to put it with some parlays, all right? And if you want to lay the 240, fine. I don't have a problem with it, but I'm just giving this to you right now. It's minus 240, and I'm giving you the numbers here. Simon, 8 of those last 9 fights have gone the distance. Ray Borg, 9 straight fights have gone the distance. Give me this fight to go the distance.
Yeah, it's a big number there at minus 240 for this fight to go the distance. But it's worth it, given those numbers that you're saying. Ray Borg, 9 consecutive fights going the distance. Ricky Simon, 8 out of 9. We expect the same here in this 15-minute battle. Gabe likes Ricky despite the number there. And throwing it in a parlay, going the distance, and getting a little extra juice could be worth it for you on fight night. One last fight we do want to mention, and you're going with somebody that hasn't exactly looked great in his last few fights. It's Michael Johnson, lightweight. This one's part of the prelim card on ESPN Plus, and you're banking on Michael Johnson, a guy that hasn't had all that much success as of late. How come?
Well, you know what? I'm going to take my chance here that Michael Johnson is going to, old MJ, is going to punch his opponent like the other MJ punched Steve Kerr and pretty much everybody else on the Chicago Bulls as we're fighting out. And I'll tell you what. Michael Johnson, I think, has been fighting since Michael Jordan was still playing and since Michael Jackson was still singing. Michael Johnson's been around, Greg. He's been around the block, and you're right, you mentioned it. He's 2-5 in his last 7 fights. But let's consider a couple of the losses. One of those losses was to a fighter named Khabib. You ever heard of Khabib? I think people know who Khabib is. Oh, yeah, the other guy he lost to, Justin Gaethje. Yeah, so yeah, there's no shame in that, as we say in the mixed martial arts. Business. He needs to let it fly. Otherwise, he's probably going to be set free and he's going to fly away from the UFC after this. The UFC has been patient with him. They like him. He's been with the company for a long time. He's an entertaining fighter. But a lot of times, Greg, you lose 3 fights in a row and you're shown the door in the UFC. He's 2-5 in his last 7. They're giving him an opponent that he needs to win. You got to read between the lines sometimes when you bet on this stuff, guys. And he's not fighting Gaethje, all right? He's not fighting Khabib right now. He's not fighting a Conor McGregor right now. He's fighting a 25-year-old kid who, if he can't beat, it probably means he's going to get fired. I think the desperation and the experience and the veteranship, this should be – they booked this fight for him to win this fight, Greg, all right? They don't want to fire him. You know what I mean? It's one of these deals. We don't want to fire you, dude. So please don't screw up today at work. It's one of these deals. They don't want to fire him. They gave him an opponent he can beat. Give me Michael Johnson.
Michael Johnson trying to save his career right now in the UFC. They don't want to get rid of him. He doesn't want to leave. All he's got to do is win on Wednesday night. Gabe expects that's exactly what will happen. There you have it. That's this week's FanDuel Hurry Up previewing the UFC card on Wednesday night. Gabe, we appreciate your time. Good luck on Wednesday.
Always a pleasure, guys. May the winners be yours.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for watching. We'll be back later in the week as NASCAR is coming back, and we'll break it down right here on the FanDuel Hurry Up.